Why don't we get started? So I think we're going, let's start with Robert Barrow.
So I wanted to discuss an application I've been working on of the rare macro disasters framework to the environmental protection area. This may be the extent of my knowledge about environmental economics, but we'll see if there's a useful contribution here. Actually, I think that this framework may apply better to the environmental area than to the original area of application, which was about macroeconomics. So a key feature in this analysis is that the potential costs associated with environmental problems have the characteristic that they're low probability but large when they occur. So there's some fat tail uncertainty that's central here. And in the baseline case, I think about an environmental disaster as reducing GDP each year by 10% or 20% and so on. There's some size distribution of these disaster events that's being considered. Another central feature is there's a technology available to a policymaker that may mitigate disaster risk. So in the main analysis, I model that as reducing the probability of disasters, but it would be basically analogous if you modeled it instead as reducing the potential size, that is having an inward contraction of the size distribution of the disasters would be a very similar way of thinking about the problem. So the basic problem I consider is what is the optimal amount of investment that should be undertaken. So as I already mentioned, fat tail uncertainty is a central feature. Also critical in the model is a significant degree of risk aversion, which tends to put a lot of weight on mitigating the potential for these rare disaster events. And I should say as an aside that the standard deterministic neoclassical growth model, even though I've spent a lot of time on it and I dearly love that framework, it's not really adequate for this purpose because it doesn't model uncertainty risk in a serious way. And the shortcomings there are quite analogous to the standard model not really being able to explain the equity premium puzzle. It really is part of the same package of things. The baseline model that I deal with has a representative agent, and there are IID shocks in the model to GDP, which correspond to IID shocks to consumption. And I think of these disturbances as emanating either from environmental causes or from other causes, being the ones I've examined in detail in previous research. A simplifying assumption in the basic analysis, which can be relaxed, is that the probability of environmental disaster depends only on the contemporaneous ratio of environmental investment to GDP. So the policymaker can do something through investment to lower the probability, but the baseline model doesn't have any characteristic where things are accumulating over time, and that influences this probability. But that can be added in a more serious dynamic analysis. Okay, the baseline model, which I'm not going to write down here, has characterizing the optimal solution, a pretty straightforward first order condition, which I'm going to just try to describe here in words without writing down any equations. So the first point, which is related to what is the appropriate discount rate for thinking about environmental issues, is that on the left-hand side of the key first order condition is the appropriate discount rate that emerges in the model that I'm considering. So the model is one with the Lucas trees that are spitting out GDP, and there's uncertainty about future GDP and consumption. And then you can think about the pricing of that tree, which corresponds to an unlevered equity claim. And the relevant discount rate that's going to appear in this first order condition for environmental investment is the dividend price ratio on that type of asset. The dividend price ratio there is intimately connected to the expected rate of return on equity, which you can think about as the expected rate of return on capital. So the left-hand side of this central first order condition in this model involves a high discount rate, something related to returns on capital and equity. But nevertheless, in this model, it's going to be the case that you can justify quite a substantial amount of intervention in the form of environmental investment. And that's because of the right-hand side of the first order condition. In other words, the left-hand side does not have a low discount rate, as in the Stern review, even if the pure rate of time preference is low because of the uncertainty factors. The right-hand side of the first order condition expresses the benefit at the margin from investing to lower the probability of disaster, or it could be the size distribution of disasters. Now, that tends to be quite large, particularly because the disasters are very risky. They have fat-tailed uncertainty. People have substantial risk aversion. And moreover, using the standard way of modeling environmental disasters as lost GDP, environmental disasters have a strong positive covariance with GDP and consumption. And that makes it particularly beneficial to be lowering the probability of those events. So you can think about various elements in the model that influence the benefit expression on the right-hand side of the central first order condition. So I've just listed here some of the possible variations that affect how large the benefit is and therefore affects how much investment you do in equilibrium. First off, one thing that's important is how effective is this intervention policy in actually reducing disaster probability or size. So some parameters are involved in characterizing that in the model, but the larger the effectiveness, the more you're going to do. The second thing is that the baseline environmental disaster probability, which I call Q of zero. Zero means it applies when you're doing nothing, which is when the investment ratio tau is equal to zero. If that's higher, then there's going to be a bigger benefit from intervening. Thirdly, the potential size distribution of the disaster events is obviously important. The larger the potential size, the more you're going to do. And fourth, the higher the coefficient of relative risk aversion, the more you're going to end up with investing to mitigate the disaster risk. In the baseline model that I calibrate, I take a coefficient of relative risk aversion around 3, which is a value that emerged in the previous research I've done on rare macroeconomic disasters. It's also true in this model that the intertemporal elasticity of substitution doesn't matter much for the results. So I'm using an Epstein-Zinn type framework where there's a distinction between the coefficient of relative risk aversion, which is quite important for the results, and the intertemporal elasticity of substitution, which turns out not to matter very much. And this is actually consistent with some conjectures put forward by Marty Weitzman, where he argued that the problem of environmental investment was not really very much about how to smooth consumption over time, but rather how much society should be investing to essentially buy insurance against disaster risk, which in this model corresponds to lowering the probability of these events. In calibrating the model to get some quantitative results, I rely as far as possible on the empirical findings from empirical research about macro disasters. So the parameters I'm able to calibrate from the previous work include the coefficient of relative risk aversion gamma, which I mentioned is around 3. I also have some information about the pure rate of time preference rho, which has to be such as to deliver the kind of empirically appropriate risk-free rate as well as the equity premium, and the probability of non-environmental disasters, other kinds of events, also comes from the previous research. Now, just quickly in terms of that previous work, the underlying data involve a sample of 40 countries with annual data on GDP going back in many cases to 1870. And from that data set, we estimated macro disasters defined as contractions in per capita GDP over a relatively short period of 10% or more. Now, it turned out with that criterion, the only macro disasters that were seen in this history of 40 countries over 100 years were events related to war, Great Depression and related types of financial crisis events. And the only other set of events were associated with the great influenza epidemic of 1918 to 20. So in particular, I think this is surprising, there were no events of 10% or more GDP declines associated with the various categories of natural disasters, and certainly not with environmental disasters. None of those are realizations in this history. Now, given that, it becomes more difficult to calibrate how potentially important environmental disasters are. The approach I follow in the current paper is to think about the size distribution of the non-environmental disasters, wars, financial crises, et cetera, as being informative about potential environmental disasters. So I used a size distribution I've estimated before to gauge what environmental disasters might look like. Now, this may not be a correct approach. It actually is an approach that's favored to some extent in the Stern Review itself, but that doesn't mean that it's a correct way of treating this problem. This is just a picture to summarize the empirical work in terms of gauging macroeconomic disasters from the long-term history for 40 countries. It turned out there are 185 events. The average size, contingent on being at least 10%, is 21%. The biggest single observation is for Germany at the end of World War II, which had a contraction by over 70%. And you can see overall the nature of the frequency distribution in terms of sizes. It looks to some extent like a power law, actually. Now, there are two other key parameters in the analysis, more specifically related to environmental issues, that I have a more difficult time calibrating. So one is, what is the baseline environmental disaster probability if you don't do anything? That's this Q of zero. And in the initial work, I take that to be 1% per year, which is somewhat arbitrary. And the results are sensitive to that. If it's a 0.5% per year or something smaller, you get very different answers for how much should be invested. The second thing that matters is about policy effectiveness. So there's a parameter that tells you how much of a result do you get in terms of reducing disaster probability if you invest more. And there's not too much information available about what that is. I look at a range of possibilities, and in some of the work, I explicitly take account of the fact that there's a lot of uncertainty about the true value of this parameter. So that has some influence on optimal policy. Okay, with the, if you take the parameters in the baseline range that I've been discussing, you can easily justify the kind of result that the Stern Review emphasizes, which is an investment ratio of 1% of GDP or more. So even though the discount rates in my analysis, I think, are kind of reasonable and realistic and much higher than in the Stern Review, you can get numbers for environmental investment that are as high or higher than they advocate. And that's because the benefit of reducing the disaster probability is so important with this fat-tailed uncertainty, which is not really part of the analysis in the Stern Review. On the other side, it's also possible with reasonable parameters in terms of the environmental ones that you can also get the result of tau equals zero, that is, that you should do nothing. So that's a kind of uncomfortable range of results that's produced here, and I'm not sure that this is avoidable. If you think about discount rates and how they interact with other variables, such as environmental investment, it depends what it is in terms of underlying parameters that's producing the change in the discount rate. So if you think about a different value of the pure rate of time preference, which I call rho, then you get results along the lines of the Stern Review. So if you have a lower pure rate of time preference, you get a lower discount rate and you get more investment being optimal. That's what's in the review. If there are other parameters that are varying, you get very different conclusions. So if you think, for example, about a different coefficient of relative risk aversion, if that's higher, you end up with a higher discount rate in my model, a higher expected return on equity, but you also end up with more investment because the benefit on the right-hand side of the first order condition that I mentioned is also substantially kicked up, and that effect dominates. So in other cases, you get a pattern where high discount rates go along with high investment. Now, the review does stress that uncertainty is critical for evaluating environmental intervention. That's indicated in the quote here about trying to manage very large risks, although they don't really do a lot formally with this argument in the review. Now, my conclusion is that this perspective is correct if you think about fat-tailed uncertainty of the outcomes in terms of environmental catastrophes being really large and consequential. Then you get that more of that kind of uncertainty goes along with more investment. But it's different if you think about uncertainty about policy effectiveness. If you think you don't really know how your intervention matters, that tends to produce less investment being optimal, although it's not universally the case. That's the result in the examples, at least, that I've looked at thus far. And that issue is analogous to one that Brainerd looked at a long time ago in terms of monetary policy uncertainty. Not knowing the effectiveness tends to reduce how much you want to do in terms of intervention. Baseline model thinks of environmental damage as equivalent to lost GDP in consumption, which I think is a standard approach in this area. That has important consequences because it means that there's a lot of riskiness associated with environmental things because of the strong positive covariance with consumption. More generally, the answers will depend on how ordinary consumption and environmental amenities substitute for each other in terms of some overall utility function. So one case I looked at as an alternative to the standard one is where utility involves separable terms, one involving ordinary consumption and the other involving environmental amenities, which is different from environmental catastrophes being lost GDP. So in that case, you can get that the relevant discount rate is much lower than in the initial model. So instead of being something like the expected return on equity, you get that the discount rate can be closer to the risk-free rate. It can be arbitrarily close to the risk-free rate. So it's a much lower hurdle rate of return. However, you would think that that would mean you would do more investment, but in fact it goes the other way because the benefit of intervening to reduce disaster probability is also much reduced when the way environmental amenities enter is in this separable manner. And in the quantitative work I've done, this second force dominates, so you get actually a weaker case for environmental investment when you have this alternative way of thinking about how it appears in utility. Now, the baseline model has a present versus future trade-off in the sense of that if you take more of your GDP and put it into environmental investment, you have less consumption today. The benefit is this lower disaster probability, and that tends to raise the likely level of GDP and consumption in all of the future periods. So there's a present versus future trade-off, and that's central in determining the optimal investment. But the trade-off looks the same at every point in time, and that's why in the baseline model, the optimal environmental investment ratio is a constant. It can be substantial, but it doesn't have any dynamic to it. Now, in contrast, particularly in a lot of the work by Bill Nordhaus, he's argued that optimal environmental investment has a kind of ramp-up property, whereby it's likely to be the case that currently you don't want to do much, but in the future you're going to do much more in terms of environmental investment. So that's not what I get in the baseline model. I think a kind of dynamic extension of the framework may produce results that resemble that pattern. So if you have, for example, that the environmental disaster probability, or it could be the size of disasters, depends on something like the accumulated stock of GDP and related environmental damages, then you can get a pattern where possibly initially the disaster probability associated with the environment is very low and doing stuff doesn't matter very much and it's not worth doing it. But if you don't do something for a long time and this relevant stock accumulates, then you can get eventually into a region where you'd want to do more so that you'd have a positive and perhaps rising environmental investment ratio. So I think it's the case, I'm working on this currently, that an enrichment of the underlying structure to include more dynamics may replicate the kind of ramp-up property that Nordhaus has emphasized with regard to optimal environmental investment. Okay.
Great, thanks. Our next panelist will be Raj Mehra.
Thank you, Ken, for inviting me. This is based on a paper of mine, and I'm going to try to summarize it in 15 minutes. That's what time I had. So I'm going to touch on three things. I'm going to present an example that illustrates that evaluating alternate abatement policies that affect the growth path of an economy based on their impact on asset valuation may not be a good measure of welfare. Then I'm going to argue that the current debate on the appropriate long-run discount rate is a red herring. Discount rates will in general be invariant, will not be invariant to policy intervention. So once you start intervening, these discount rates are going to change. And then briefly address some issues arising from heterogeneity in households, because this is a global phenomenon. I see some faces here are old enough to realize that the economics here is no different than Jensen and Long in 1972 and Merton and Subramaniam on the symposium on the optimality of capital markets, I think it was 74. Let's go through an example, dive into an example. Consider two Lucas endowment economies. They're identical in every respect, except that one has a growth rate of consumption of 2%. While the other has a growth rate of 1%. And I'm going to make it really simple, there is no uncertainty. There's a single infinitely lived household with constant relative risk aversion preferences. Each household's elasticity of intertemporal substitution, there is no uncertainty here, is 0.5, beta is 0.9. None of these results will crucially depend on these parameters. Consumption levels are one in both economies at time one. Land is the only asset in the economy. It entitles its owner to the entire consumption stream. Okay, in this economy, you can price an asset very standardly, and I'm not going to spend any time on that. Also in this economy, an equilibrium can exist with beta is equal to one. I want to come back to it when you discuss equity issues across generations. Now, let PL high growth be the price of the land in the high growth economy, and PL low growth be the price of the land in the low growth economy. And I want to ask you guys a question. What is the relative valuation of land in the two economies in terms of today's consumption goods? So all the information you need is here. There's nothing tricky here. You start at one, and one economy grows at 2%, and the other one grows at 1%. Now, clearly, if you prefer more to less, which economy would you like to live in, the high growth one or the low growth one? High growth economy, you consume more. I mean, there's no trick here. Okay, now the question is, so this is, one is growing at 2%, the other is growing at 1%. The question is, how much more valuable would be the land in the high growth economy relative to the low growth economy? Would it be twice as valuable, 10 times, 50 times, some other number? Any guesses? Well, you may be surprised. It's only half as valuable. I presented it at a couple of climate conferences. I think Bob was there at the first one when we presented it. I was the who's who of the climate economists, and their estimates range 20 times more valuable to 50 to even 100. But it's actually half as valuable. And if alpha was one, they would be the same. The thing is that you can see the household welfare is higher in the higher growth economy, irrespective of your risk aversion. You're consuming more. But the discount rate changes when the growth rate changes. It's endogenous to policy So in the high growth economy, the discount rate is 4.1, while in the low growth, it's 2.1. See, this is all, you know, it's the, back to the old debate on if you take an investment, does it affect the market portfolio or the market portfolio, or you're an atomistic agent. When you are no longer an atomistic agent, and I would argue that macroeconomic policy interventions are not atomistic, then you really do have to take into account the effect of your policy or change in the growth rate on the discount rate. So if you use the social discount rate to calculate the present value of costs and benefits of a policy, I've just given you an example. This is not a good measure of the welfare consequences of that policy. And you can see that this is the price of land in the high growth versus the low growth, and the price of the land in the high growth is, you know, can be half as much as the price of the land in the low growth. Okay, now let's look at a very stylized. I just want to make a simple point, which I think is missing, I may be completely wrong, is from a lot of the integrated assessment models. Okay, so let's consider a world with no intervention, absolutely no intervention. Again, none of these things, I just made it very simple for a 15-minute presentation, but per capita consumption grows at 2%. I mean, that's historically one of the more solid numbers in macroeconomics, per capita consumption growing it. And for 10 years, it would be 50, 100, 150, and thereafter grows at 1% in perpetuity. The point is that this is trying to capture that if you do nothing about abatement, you know, you're going to get a high growth rate now, but down the road, this growth rate is going to decline because of the effects of greenhouse gas. Now consider an abatement policy which reduces per capita consumption by X percent, where X is 1%, 2%, or 3% for 10 years, but the growth rate remains constant, 2% indefinitely. So let's do a little picture. So this is basically the case where you have business as usual, it goes up to T, you do nothing about it, you have a high growth rate, and then at some point, it could be, you know, gradual, but I'm just making it very stark here, the growth rate comes to 1%. Or I could spend some money in abatement, and this need not be it could be in any way, it could be investment technology which will reduce CO2 in the future, or it could be just you know, current abatement. It lowers the level effect, and it grows at 2% for 10 years, then goes up, and it's back again. It's consistent with a lot of the literature, which will argue that you know, you need the next 50 to 100 years where you need to put this investment. All right, you can see the present value of this policy with abatement is always less, so I'm going to use alpha is equal to 2, although there's no uncertainty. So think about it as elasticity of intertemporal substitution being half, beta is 0.98, T is 50 years, 100 years, 150, perpetuity, this serves as an integrity check. I mean, if you were never going to, if you're going to lose it forever, this will be down by 1%, this will be down by 2%, this will be 3%. But you can see you would not abate. Because in this world, if you just measured the cost benefit of this thing, by the way, this is completely equilibrium. So the discount rates will change in both these environments. But look at what we do. Now I'm going to calculate the welfare impact with the two policies. I'm going to look at lifetime consumption equivalence as in Lucas 87 and Tellerini 2000. So using the no abatement policy as the base case, this is the fraction of consumption that would make a household indifferent between the two policies. The details are in the paper, but I'm going to put down many people in finance, I realize, are not familiar with lifetime consumption equivalence. So I'm going to put down just the equations. So you have, without abatement, you got your lifetime consumption, you got your you know, present value of the utility. Of course, the growth rate is going to be low. This is high growth rate up to 10, and then after, from T plus 1, the growth rate is going to change. And with abatement, what is going to happen is that you're going to only consume 1 minus x now. This is the compensation that you would need, but the growth rate would remain the same before and after t. And if you equate these two, you can solve for lambda, which is the fraction by which the compensation under abatement must be increased to make the household indifferent to abatement policy. Now the surprise. If you do this for 50 years, irrespective of whether you take 1, 2, or 3%, the lambda is negative. What does that mean? That tells you that households are willing to sacrifice consumption in addition to that required by the abatement policy to avoid a reduction in future growth rates. And you can see for values of parameters alpha and beta here, if you have t equal to 50 years, if you had a planner who was looking at discounting at the social discount rate, they would not go for abatement. But if you were looking at lifetime consumption equivalence, so a policymaker would not choose abatement based on market valuation, although it has a higher welfare in each instance. This is something that I wanted to point out here. And given the fact that all these integrated, there's so much of uncertainty. If you read the literature, it's all over the place in terms of the uncertainty in these things. But we have abstracted from the danger is a positive catastrophic feedback loop. So our analysis would favor. So basically, you are basically neutral even up to 100 years in terms of welfare consequences. So think about this as an insurance policy. The way I like to look at these things is, you know, if you come down to Niagara Falls, and this was years ago when I was a kid, somebody pointed out to me, you could be coming in a boat and you could not even see the falls, but there will be a point where it's the point of no return. Human muscle power will not pull the boat. So deterministically, you will go overboard. You will think it's business as usual, and that's the thing that you want to avoid. So what I have in mind in discussing this is that you have a time path of atmospheric CO2 concentration. Then you have a functional which maps that time path into temperature. Okay? That's the science. As economists, we have nothing to say about it, and we shouldn't try to second guess on that. Now that you have the temperature, there are two parts to it that fork out. One is you can look at, like a Gaussian type of uncertainty, which you can work out the cost, benefits, other things like that. The other thing would be a tipping point where basically some scientists would have to tell you that if you go beyond this point, you are going to go into a wreck, an environmental disaster. So I would say that, look, you can change around. The MATLAB programs are available. You can play around with these parameters, and you can see that this is just insurance. And Bob was pointing that out, Robert was pointing that out a little earlier, that a lot of this has to do with insurance against a catastrophe. Okay, so the stylized example illustrates the policy interventions that are not marginal. See, we're all used to thinking marginal interventions so that the discount rate remains constant. So an R minus G type of framework where R remains constant and G goes up, and there you have a huge impact on asset valuation. Here, R changes with G should not be evaluated on the basis of asset valuation using social discount factors, but rather using lifetime consumption equivalence. And I think, you know, this is a personal view, that the current obsession in the environmental literature on discount factors is at best misguided when analyzing macroeconomic interventions. It's fine. I mean, you can use them if these are infinitesimal interventions, but when you're looking at macroeconomic, this is a small example which shows that. The last point I want to make is household heterogeneity. So most of the literature assumes a global representative household. But the reality is large parts of population in India, China, Sub-Saharan Africa live at near subsistence levels of consumption. The person who is, you know, trying to survive for the next day, their marginal elasticity of intertemporal substitution is going to be very different. So this group conservatively accounts for a third of the global households, and they're willing to substitute consumption over time is quite different. Lending rates for this subset of households is likely to be much lower than implied by capital market data. So if you're looking at Disney bonds and things like that to infer discount rates, I think that's a non-starter here. Let's see here. To consider a variation of a habit model with the subsistence here. So it's C minus C bar, which is just the subsistence level. And you can compute the coefficient of relative risk aversion. And poor households are likely to have consumption levels which are just about subsistence. So if C bar over CT is about approximately 0.9, you can see that the effective coefficient of risk aversion jacks up to 20. So consequently, the risk aversion for poor households is likely to be very large and very small elasticity of intertemporal substitution. So how does one deal with heterogeneity? Well, unfortunately, we all know a social welfare function cannot be constructed in general if household preferences are heterogeneous. Under conditions, when preferences satisfy conditions for aggregation, then you can construct a representative agent in a manner that is independent of the underlying heterogeneous agent economy's initial wealth distribution. But that limits the class of preference functions dramatically. In this example, I've been using CRRA preferences, and let me just add that I've done it with Epstein's in also. So the basic things wouldn't change, but the key thing is Epstein's in preferences do not allow for aggregation. So any welfare analysis using Epstein's in you have to bite the bullet, and it's a global dictator. I mean, there is no hand waving or a fig leaf saying that, look, there may be an underlying economy and I can aggregate a representative agent. So economists can evaluate the impact of a policy on the welfare of each heterogeneous class of agents, but weighing the interest of different classes is an ethical issue, which I think we have very little to say about. Thank you.
Great.
Thanks, Russ. The next speaker is Lars.
I think he's, here we go.
There we go, okay. I'm gonna take a little bit different attack. There's been lots of interesting work showing how to use the tools of asset pricing and in highly stylized models to get some insights. It seems to be like at some point in time we need to do a more serious job of connecting to what climate science is telling us and the uncertainties that come from there, and we have to roll up our sleeves and get serious about the intertemporal and dynamic natures of that. And there's some interesting challenges there, and I think it's going to really make us kind of think through problems in an interesting way. So I want to take a little bit of inventory on this on this challenge. So certainly we'd agree that source of uncertainty is endemic in the economic analyses of global climate change, and the forecasts from climate models over decades are of limited reliability, even though they simulate them out for centuries and centuries, but it's presumably reliability becomes an issue. For economics, we know that our reliability of our models over long time periods are also quite suspicious. And as well as the economic impacts of climate change are certainly unknown, and so this is challenged. We just confront this uncertainty, or do we use it as a reason to dismiss modeling endeavors? Of course, I would like to not dismiss the modeling endeavors. So here's a quote from the IPCC. It's talking about the nature of uncertainties that at least they see. And it's kind of uncertainty can result from a wide range of sources. Including evaluating the causation in complex multi-component processes, span biological, physical, and human systems. Complex interactions over multiple climate and non-climate influences change over time can lead to persistent uncertainties. So the question is, how do we as model builders capture this type of stuff? There's a really interesting, I thought, op-ed by Kunin in the Wall Street Journal that if you Google this, climate scientists hate it because of some of the they challenged some of the evidence that he gave in this. But on the other hand, this statement here, to me at least, is not so controversial. And any serious discussion of changing climate must acknowledge not only scientific certainties, but also uncertainties, especially projecting the future. Recognizing these limits rather than ignoring them will lead to more sober and ultimately more productive discussions of climate change and climate policies. So it seems to me the challenge for economists is to somehow connect to the type of uncertainties which climate scientists are also trying to cope with in their models and the like. I find it useful to differentiate multiple components to uncertainty, and I like to break it apart into three pieces. The first piece is the one that we kind of routinely use in a big fraction of our models. We impose rational expectations. People inside our models have everything figured out, and that we model things using standard risk tools. So once I know the model, I know the probabilities of everything, and then I can do all the relevant calculations. This has been a demonstrably hugely successful paradigm. It's been an important one in a variety of contexts. In some situations, though, I suspect it's been pushed a little bit too far, and it's good to step back and look at a little bit uncertainty a little bit more generally. There's another kind of component to uncertainty that has a long history to addressing that I think is also important. I think of this as model ambiguity. I've got multiple models on the table. I don't know which is the right one. I have to figure out how to weight them. And how much confidence am I going to put in each of these different competing models which are on the table? And this is certainly an area in which there's competing models which have to be confronted. And the third one is maybe the most important component to uncertainty and the hardest one to really capture or formally model. The models we write down, the climate models themselves can be incredibly complicated. There's been literature I'll be talking about shortly about how to take those complicated models and try to make them more simple and more stylized. But they're wrong. They have flaws. We know they're wrong. How do we, when we're trying to capture uncertainties, capture the notion that the models aren't quite correct? We think they're simplifications. We think they're useful, but on the other hand, taking them literally as producing all the relevant probabilities seems to be quite a stretch. And I think it would be certainly the case in this area as well. So indeed, it's this third component of uncertainty that may be the most challenging, and in many respects may well be the most important. Now, for economists, there's two types of uncertainty, and this is how it differentiates from some other scientific disciplines. We have the usual econometrician's uncertainty, and the econometric, I come from an econometrics background, and I know that I'm all the time trying to struggle with what the relevant parameters, how to estimate them, which among competing set of models are correct, or how do I test them, or the like, and kind of wrestling with those issues. And that's kind of, I think about it, that is uncertainty outside of a model. So a model, once I write down a model, it tells me all the probabilities of everything, but I'm an external analyst, and I just have to, figure some stuff out and use evidence to do that. And I think about that as uncertainty outside of a model. And that's what kind of statisticians are very used to. This is what econometricians are very, very used to. For as economists, we also have we have people inside our models. And the people inside our models are making decisions. And they have to confront these components of uncertainty. And we do that in a way in which they've got everything sorted out and it's just us, these kind of naive econometricians outside that kind of can't figure stuff out? Or do we really want to pass along those same struggles to people inside models? And I think that's a potentially fruitful way to, fruitful type of questions to be asking. And it's kind of known through lots of examples that how we model these different statements of how we treat uncertainty inside models can be tremendously important and can have important implications. So there's kind of two types of levers that get pushed here about how do we enhancing responses to uncertainty. So if you look at a lot of macroeconomic models that came out of the real business cycle type and the new Keynesian type and the like, uncertainty is literally a second order consideration. It's by its very nature, it's very second order. And in these type of environments, we really believe uncertainty should be first order. And there's two ways in which we achieve this. One is by increasing the exposure to uncertainty. So this is what this kind of fat tail risk is all about and the like. And I think going forward, we have to kind of we have to get out of this notion that we're just going to draw off of some tail of some distribution and it's kind of a static way. I think tools like looking at how large deviation theory tells us how uncertainty unravels over time and under certain configurations leads you know, lead us to tails and other ones don't. But I think, you know, this is a problem in which is inherently very, very dynamic, and we have to be kind of thinking about the interaction between nonlinearities and how the uncertainty unravels. And you know, even if we care, you know, even if we want to approach things by some forms of so-called tail risk, it's kind of a we need kind of a dynamic notion of that. But there's also enhanced the concern about the uncertainty. If we're sitting here as a decision maker and we really struggle with what's the correct model, we struggle with how to even put probabilities over things, how should that affect our decision making? Should that be an extra source of caution? Should we have people be more cautious just because of their lack of understanding of how models work? And I think there's an interesting argument to be made for precisely that. Although Bob Barrow's an exception, a lot of the literature on recursive utility looks at very, very high values of risk aversion. 10 has become a bit, has become a modest literature, a modest amount in the asset pricing literature. There's papers that go all the way up to 100. I mean, at some point in time, this parameter we call risk aversion is some mongrel of something else, and the question is what else is this a mongrel of, and how else can we think about people having enhanced responses to uncertainty other than just a pure, narrowly defined risk aversion story. There's three type of modeling challenges, I think. Should we go beyond the rational expectations risk analysis? I think it's valuable to do just that. How do we construct robust weighting across models? And then how do we use misspecified models in sensible ways? So let me talk about the second one first. People say, well, didn't Savage solve this problem? Diffinetti solved this problem? That is, Savage wrote this beautiful axiomatic system that delivered on subjective probabilities. And this is what we learn in our micro classes, and it's a wonderfully elegant axiomatic treatment of the subject. Well, Savage himself says, no matter how neat modern operational definitions of personal probability may look, it's usually possible to determine personal probabilities of events only very crudely. And kind of the intellectual motivator for Savage and for kind of the initiator of subjective probabilities in many respects was Diffinetti. And he was also saying subjectives should feel obliged to recognize that any opinion is only vaguely acceptable. So, you know, this idea that we can just wave our hands, become Bayesians, and it's solved, I mean, it's just, it isn't, I don't think, and there's non-trivial issues about how we do weighting, and there's a very interesting literature on kind of robust Bayesian statistics that's all about sensitivity analyses. Suppose I look at weightings across different models, I start jiggling around the weightings, how do they matter? And if they matter, you know, what might we do about that? Now, here's a picture that's shown up in a lot of the climate economic literatures. This is a paper by Milner, but actually produced by Menhauser and others. And this produces histograms of a key climate sensitivity parameter across a whole bunch of different models. So you think there's heterogeneity across models. This is kind of ugly and hard to tell apart, but it should at least convince you there's a lot of heterogeneity in the probabilities that come out of each individual model itself. And so we have to figure out ways we're going to weight across all those different models. And that's, you know, it's a non-trivial thing, and that, you know, this is a case where sensitivity analyses, I think, would be absolutely critical to be doing. So there's some stabs at this, so-called robust Bayesian. And once you enter the Bayesian paradigm, there's also the issue of learning. So we suspect in this climate literature, the key parameters are things we'll only learn about very, very slowly. And therefore, the robustness adjustments may well be persist as well. Because if you're learning about stuff really, really, really quickly, kind of we know from Bayesian statistics that there's prior sensitivity washes out as more and more data comes along. But these are situations in which probably learning is taking place very, very slowly. But there are interesting things to be done about learning. You know, one of the arguments for delay in action could be, well, let's wait till we get more information about key parameters, and then once we get that information, then act. Or do we act now because it's going to be very, very costly to wait? And those type of trade-offs, I think, are really critical about, so kind of the only tools I know to think about this is kind of robust notions of Bayesian learning, under which you kind of take into account the weakness of the data which is available, and then do this trade-off between acting now and acting in the future. There's been kind of a literature which has kind of picked up on this from decision theory. I think of Klebanoff et al. Kind of smooth ambiguity models as an example of this. It's been applied in the climate economics by Milner and Dietz and Heal and others. I've done some of this stuff in other settings as well with Sargent. But these are cases in which you have agents, decision makers, that have some uncertainty about how to weight the different models, but they look at the utility consequences of the different weightings. And when the adverse consequences are large, then you might tilt your weightings towards in ways that are much more cautious. And it delivers dynamic stories of caution and ways in which, you know, when should people behave more cautiously and when should they not, based on kind of making these robust adjustments to how you weight models. Now, there's this other issue, though. The models, the models all, in some sense, are wrong. And how do we kind of start thinking about using them in sensible ways? And there's another issue here in the climate literature. The models are inherently very, very complex, and they're not terribly transparent, and they're not very tractable to use for a lot of calculations. And that's led people to try to think about simplifications of them and ways, you know, kind of relevant simplifications. And this is what we've had to do within the economics literature, because we need these climate inputs, the inputs that tell us stuff about how emissions impact temperature. We know that need those to be fairly simple and fairly tractable. So there's a recent paper that kind of looks across the so-called DICE models, which Nordhaus has been well known for. And kind of looks at kind of the comparisons of, feeds through emission trajectories and look through comparisons, what comes out of those models versus what comes out of some of the more richer climate models, including even simplified approximations of those models. And here the time horizon is going to matter. So here's a case where we kind of feed through some type of temporary increase in emissions, which kind of goes up and then eventually down, and then look at the consequences on temperature across these different models. The lower curves here tell us what's used typically in the economic models, and out of the climate science come these upper curves. Now, they hug each other for quite a while here, so there's a sense in which they're good approximations for a while. And maybe they're good enough approximations, given discounting, that we don't care what happens off in the tails here. But the models do behave differently in the tails eventually, and it's kind of a relevant calculation to be done inside economic models, whether these differences are important or things which we can just kind of ignore. And I don't know how to address this short of rolling up our sleeves and kind of investigating the consequences of these type of specification errors on the actual decision problems which interest us. Oh my gosh, my pick. Okay, one set of climate scientists have been trying to argue, yes, there's this very complicated relationship as you go to emissions, to what happens to CO2 going into the atmosphere, to then what happens to temperature. And part of the fat tailness comes through the relationship between CO2 in the atmosphere and what happens to temperature. And they say, well, there's kind of two things going, there's kind of these two pieces to it. There's the emissions to concentrations, the concentrations to climate change, and there's even feedbacks that take place. So on the top part here kind of indicates the typical climate model with sometimes the feedbacks being not, even appropriately captured. And they're trying to argue that it may be simpler to go with a simpler modeling paradigm is to go straight from emissions to climate change, because of some of the uncertainties offset each other. It's kind of a very interesting argument that there's kind of a, by short-circuiting some of the dynamics, you actually some of the uncertainties kind of cancel themselves out. And so this is a point that Matthews has made in a variety of papers. Pierre Humbert as well has made it recently in some work. And so kind of what goes on here is we think about the impulse responses of, this is a case where there's an increase in, there's a sustained increase in emissions. And then we look at the impulse responses of kind of what happens to temperature changes over the carbon in the atmosphere. That's that kind of red line. What happens to carbon in the atmosphere relative to the emissions? That's kind of the blue line. Those are impulse response functions. One goes, starts up and comes down. The other starts down and goes up. They kind of roughly cancel each other out. And there's a sense in which you get a very kind of flat response if you kind of look at the composite relationship between the two. And arguably, there's maybe less uncertainty by just going straight from the emissions to the temperature. To the extent that's true, it's a really wonderful simplification. That means we can use simpler models to address a lot of important questions. Even if you buy into this, though, there's certainly uncertainty that remains. And that's, I hope this shows up soon. There's a figure here, can't you see it? Apparently it's not gonna make it. Oh well, there it is. So even here, even this kind of, you know, even with the simplification, there's a substantial amount of uncertainty of what that response should be. And this is, these are kind of given some probability estimates over this. So this is a situation in which there's a model simplification. We have to be worried about, well, is the misspecification going to be causing us problems? The simplification is very, very nice, but we have to do some type of check on making sure the model, simplifications aren't doing violence to the underlying economics. And plus, there remains uncertainty, and that's captured at least by this plot as well. So the point I want to make is there's some valuable tools out there. If we think about uncertainty much more broadly, it opens the door to us really connecting in a more serious way to the climate models, rather than and I think that can be kind of a rich direction to go, and can open up a kind of some kind of more explicitly dynamic questions can be important. Now, what I've left off here is the damage specification. I could have a similar discussions about how we go from temperature changes to economic damages. That's something which lots of economists have speculated about, and we have maybe a little bit of evidence on, but there's tons of uncertainty about that relationship as well. And again, it seems to me like the critical part is to do interesting, serious sensitivity analyses across what different models tell us about how to weight the different models, and to look at what the consequences are for misspecification. Anyway. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Lars. Bob Litterman is next.
Is this the clicker here?
Other side. So, yeah. Hopefully. There we go.
Yeah, great. Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I've been giving climate talks for a while, and I always like to start with an example of a tail risk. This one I couldn't help but bringing because this was an accident that occurred about 4 weeks ago in New Jersey, and I happened to actually be there. My wife and I were about 2 seconds away from hitting that truck, which came at us from the other side of the freeway and was loaded with 9,000 gallons of gasoline, and we luckily made it by. But It stopped the traffic for 7 hours. But anyway, the reason I wanted to show it is because it illustrates not only that you have to think about worst case scenarios, but also there's dynamics that you have to think about when you face uncertainty. My wife saw this truck out of control heading straight at us and said, "Oh my God, watch out." Well, of course I slammed on the brakes and swerved and just missed it by a few feet. But when we think about climate risk, obviously the time horizon is much longer, but still the question is, do you brake, as Nordhaus suggests, as a slow increasing amount over time, that slow policy ramp, or do you think about it as it's time to slam on the brakes? And a lot of that depends on uncertainty, and it depends on how you expect that information to be resolved. So in this case, well, I could talk a lot about this, but luckily, we managed to survive. Now, as economists, we all know that incentives matter, and the interesting question here is, what's the right price for carbon emissions? The pricing of carbon emissions is the break that we have as a society, and so the question is, when do we put that on, and at what level? Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about stranded assets, and this is something that investors today are talking a lot about. Stranded assets are assets whose valuations will be negatively impacted by appropriate pricing of emissions. The main thing to say about stranded assets is you can think of the atmosphere's capacity to safely absorb emissions as a scarce resource. We're using that resource up. We don't really know. In this graph, the estimate has been that we have a budget of 886 gigatons of CO2, which will lead to a 80% probability of a change in temperature less than 2%. Of course, there's tremendous uncertainty about, first of all, what's a safe amount of temperature change, and secondly, what would be the relationship between emissions and temperature change. But even if you ignore that uncertainty, we're using that up. In the last 10 years, we've used up something like a third of that supposed budget, And as you can see, the implication for investors is important because there's tremendous amounts of reserves on balance sheets that, according to these estimates, cannot be burned. And so what are the implications for the valuations of those assets? Now, when we talk about where climate risk should be priced, first thing to recognize, and I think the rest of the panelists have as well, and this comes from finance theory, is that there's two kinds of risk. There's diversifiable risk and non-diversifiable risk. Clearly, climate risk is non-diversifiable, and so the pricing of that risk depends not only on the amount of risk and the expected damage, but it depends on the full distribution of potential outcomes, and it depends on the amount of risk aversion that you observe in society. And so there's a risk premium associated with climate risk. I also put on this graph the price of climate risk today below zero, because if you aggregate all of the subsidies globally to the production and consumption of fossil fuels, they're a large multiple greater than the amount of incentives that there are to reduce emissions. Now, I've been working on a model using a very similar approach to what Robert Barrow described, in the sense that there are tail events, there is Epstein-Zinn utility function, and the main result here, which I'm demonstrating in this graph, is that the standard approach, which relies on constant relative risk aversion utility, cannot capture the important element of risk in these modeling exercises. You can see the two different pricing of emissions here as a function of the amount of risk aversion. Well, in these standard constant relative risk aversion models, the change in curvature of the utility function has two effects. As you increase curvature, you raise interest rates, and therefore you raise the discount of future damages. And when these damages are well out into the future, that causes the appropriate price of emissions to go down. Whereas with Epstein-Zinn utility, you separate the curvature associated with intertemporal substitution from that associated with risk aversion. And so holding fixed intertemporal substitution, increasing the degree of risk aversion, you see the intuition of what you would expect, which is to say that the price of emissions goes up. I just show here a graph from one of the standard climate models where increasing risk aversion just has a decreasing price of emissions. And so what the standard models have done is typically assume very little risk aversion in order to find a reasonable price. And of course, that misses the whole point that it's a risk problem. I also wanted to talk just briefly about some of the implications for investors. When you think about stranded assets, and we addressed this issue a little over a year ago at the World Wildlife Fund, where I'm on the investment committee. And what we wanted to do is we wanted to hedge the risk that emissions would be priced and therefore negatively impact the valuation of those stranded assets in our portfolio. So we constructed an index of coal and tar sands, which are the two main stranded assets, and we created a swap. And I wanted to show you the results of that. This is the performance of that swap this year, which is kind of interesting. I'm sure everyone's well aware that energy prices have declined, and that's certainly true. But when you look at this graph, which shows the return on the stranded asset swap, which is 33% this year, and by the way, although we didn't have the swap on, in the previous 3 years, the annualized performance of stranded assets was 18% below that of the S&P 500. So this is a long-term decline in the valuation of stranded assets relative to the S&P. And this is probably the worst kind of empiricism, but Stanford University announced that it was divesting of coal back in the beginning of May, which is kind of the low point for this swap. David Swensen, a very respected investor who's head of the Yale Endowment, sent a letter to investors at the beginning of September saying, I want you to think about the impact on the valuations of all the assets you're managing for us. And given his influence in the investment community, that seemed to be associated with a large increase in the value of this swap. There's a small blip down when the Republicans won the election, but then with the agreement between China and the U.S. and the Lima agreement, you can see the swap has continued to do well. And finally, I want to talk a little bit about, people ask, well, how could we ever get emissions priced appropriately? And I want to talk about aviation, because I think that's an opportunity. Right now, the aviation industry has promised to create a market-based measure to reduce emissions, although unfortunately it hasn't really addressed what the appropriate level for that market-based measure is in order to create appropriate incentives. But what's nice about aviation is actually, if you think about it, they have an incentive to lead on this issue because they need that scarce resource, the ability to create emissions into the atmosphere. There's a lot of emissions on the ground now. Aviation is only about 2 or 3% of the total amount of emissions today. But going forward, if you think 10, 20 years into the future when emissions are priced, we can reduce ground-based emissions very quickly and very dramatically. But aviation is going to continue to grow in importance and continue to have to create emissions. There's no alternative technology for aviation other than burning fossil fuel. And so in order to get aviation to take this seriously, I think there is a role for owners of aviation shares to put pressure on aviation to create appropriate incentives. And so working with the World Wildlife Fund and actually major investors around the world, including especially CalPERS, we're leading an engagement with the aviation sector to, in the design of the market-based measure, create appropriate incentives. Now, interestingly, aviation has invited the World Wildlife Fund, as well as a number of other environmental organizations, to sit in on them in terms of the design of this. And the reason they've done that is because, despite their intention to create a very low price to buy offsets and credits very cheaply, they want us to say, you know, that's great, you're doing your part. That's your aspirational, you know, contribution to this. But in fact, of course, it's a great opportunity here because the aviation emissions price would be the first globally harmonized price, and therefore it would be a very important benchmark. And in particular, what we've asked is that not only the environmental organizations, but also sort of science should have a seat at this table in designing the aviation market-based measure, because only science really, along with economic modeling, can determine an appropriate price. And it would be very nice if the price for emissions were set by taking the best data and analysis that we can do and reflect the market-based measure, that reflect in the market-based measure the appropriate economic externality. Thank you.
Great.
Okay, so the plan for the rest of this is we'll have a little bit of discussion here, which I'll guide with a few questions, and then we'll open it up to questions. So let me start. One of the topics that everybody has up here has discussed is the importance of uncertainty. And obviously this raises the issue of quantifying the uncertainty. Lars, in particular, you put up a plot that showed the outcomes or the predictions of a number of scientific climate studies. And I know, for example, not to pick on any particular study, but Pindyke in one of his calibration studies basically takes the outcomes of, I think, 22 studies from the IPCC that are referenced in the IPCC and fits the distribution to these and quantifies the uncertainty in this way. Yet I suspect if you went and you spoke to those climate scientists, each of them would think they had the right, right prediction, not that theirs was part of a distribution. So I guess specifically, what would you ask from scientists if you really wanted to go in and put a number? Presumably we're doing this because we want to eventually put a number on the right price for carbon. So what do we need from scientists to really quantify the uncertainty in the way that you're thinking about? And let me have Lars start with this, but then obviously open it up to everybody else.
So there's two parts of this. So histograms are one part of it.
Do we need to press them?
Obviously,
I think he's.
Yeah, the climate scientists, you know, each climate model may want to assign probability one to their own model. So, but that doesn't mean that external people ought to be I think it's more interesting to do kind of, you know, explore different weighting schemes and look at sensitivities and see kind of where they, you know, where the differences matter and don't matter, and then we can go kind of probe more seriously on that. But I think the other issue is about, you know, how do we really confront this misspecification, which is the harder problem? You know, I mean, we can boil it down to one or two histograms over parameters, but are these models really capturing all the dynamics we need them to capture or not? And that I don't know. The only way I know how to address that is to look at how the changes in the model specification affect the outcome of the calculations that interest us. So I think that, you know, I think sensitivity analysis is just critical in this going forward.
Mm-hmm. Bob, did you want to, what do you think we need from scientists?
Well, you know, I thought the IPCC synthesis report was very interesting. It had a box from the scientists labeled the limitations of economic models of climate risk. And I happen to agree very much with what they said, which was basically, first of all, you can get almost any answer you want, ranging from $2 a ton to $200 a ton. And secondly, that they don't really trust these models because they don't take into account irreversibilities, you know, boundary crossings, et cetera, et cetera. And therefore, the appropriate price is at the high end of these distributions. Well, I'm not sure the last one, intuitively it's probably right, but it's not a very rigorous analysis. And, but I think the kind of sensitivity analysis that you can get out of, I didn't talk much about the modeling that you and I have done, Kent and I have been working on a paper together. But that sensitivity analysis kind of tells you some of what are the key issues. And, you know, for instance, the probability of tipping points and the assumptions about damages when you have a tipping point, those are very key parameters. Some of the other inputs that the economists have been really struggling with, like the pure rate of time preference, turns out aren't that important once you calibrate to things like long-term interest rates and the equity risk premium. So. You know, I think that kind of modeling is very important, but there is tremendous uncertainty here that we do have to take into account, and I think it probably does lead to raising the appropriate price of emissions because of the sort of precautionary measure. But it, you know, I'd let smarter people like Lars try and answer that.
I already failed.
Robert?
I was trying to understand better Lars's distinction between this outside and inside kind of uncertainty. I think I understood the outside part, which in terms of standard econometrics and you'd get some range of estimates. So was that being criticized because at the same time in the model, this uncertainty is not being taken account by the actors in the model? And so is it really two different kinds of uncertainty, or to some asymmetry in how uncertainty is being approached in terms of the modeling? So in the analysis I was doing that I discussed a little bit, I had some parameter that described the policy effectiveness in terms of environmental investment doing something, like lowering disaster probability. So I tried to specifically take account of the fact that that parameter really is not known in terms of coming up with the optimal investment, that was then factoring in that uncertainty. But I had no idea whether that was outside or inside stuff.
So the outside versus so the inside thing, we inside our models, our investors make decisions. They make decisions based on certain probabilities, and the question is how we have them come up with those probabilities. And so. So the original rational expectations paradigm that said that well, they know the model, they know all the and they can figure out all the probabilities. There's been relaxations to that sick and Bayesian learning inside the rational expectations paradigm, and that would be a way to go under which agents inside the model, you know, look and try to learn from data inside the model to try to figure out what parameters are, and that, you know, there's been some work along those lines. More generally. As an econometrician, I spent the first half of my career not really knowing how to address very easily all these issues about model misspecification and the like, and they seem to be first order issues. And so the harder problem is how we have people inside our model wrestle with model specifications, and you know what, how do they really look across models and form beliefs and the like. And I think that those type of struggles can imitate aversion, what we sometimes appeal to as risk aversion, because I think they're
Yeah, because if we look at standard finance stuff, we're all the time appealing to large risk aversion. You know, like Campbell Cochran, you're not risk averse in a big way all the time, but you need to be sometimes because risk prices move over. You know, risk prices move over time, and we're searching for stories for how that works. And so I want to look for other mechanisms than pure risk mechanisms. But part of when we write down a model is we have to take a statement of what people inside our model are doing and how they're coping with uncertainty. And that's the event, and that's what I mean by inside the model.
One other point to make is that it's also very important how you think that uncertainty is going to be resolved. If you think it's going to be resolved soon, you'll get a very different policy than if you think it won't be resolved for a long time. And in this context, there may be certain kinds of uncertainty, such as the response of consumers and producers to prices, that could be resolved relatively quickly, whereas other kinds of uncertainty, such as the response of the temperature to emissions, may take a long time.
I wanted to take a slightly different perspective on this, and what would I ask the scientists is to see when would we get a feasible carbon extraction process, because if we can extract carbon out of the atmosphere, the current process using calcium oxide with carbon dioxide and getting calcium carbonate, it requires a fair amount of energy to do this thing. If we could get a process where basically we can extract carbon out of the atmosphere in some reasonable manner, then the whole problem can be solved as an optimal control problem. You really don't have to go into these issues, because what happens is if I knew the time path of concentration of CO2 and what it maps into, then cap and trade would control it, because you know at each year how much of emissions you want to allow. You auction those permits off. I did some work for the IMF at one time for privatizing, Eastern European economies, and essentially, when you don't have market prices, through an auction or a atonement process, you are going to get endogenous prices of this thing. So, the ideal would be to release carbon dioxide when you are below target, and then take it out. But that technology, there's some progress towards it, but it's very I would love to know when that happens. And I want to share an anecdote with you. I did a project for Bob Lucas when I was a doctoral student at Carnegie during the oil crisis. And one of the things was substituting for coal and other things. So I actually went up to Princeton to talk to some people to see when would nuclear fusion come online. They said, well, it's around the corner, 10 years. This was in 74, and that 10 years has been going on. It's always been around the corner, so.
I thought the joke was it's always 50 years off, but and has been for 50 years. But your point, though, about direct carbon capture is an important one, and that's one of the things we saw in our model. We actually built in sort of a backstop technology. At some price, clearly you can. The estimates I've heard today is it's about $500 to $1,000 a ton. A lot of uncertainty at scale where what the cost is of removing carbon dioxide. But indeed, if you think in 20 years we'll be able to remove carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, at $100 a ton or something, that has a big impact on what the appropriate price is today.
And the same with superconductivity. I mean, that also has been around the corner to get superconductivity at a reasonable price to store electricity and smooth out that cycle.
But one other thing that's important is to recognize that these technological changes are endogenous, that they are a function of the pricing of emissions. If we don't price emissions, we have technology right now for carbon capture and sequestration. It's not being used because we don't have prices that make it economical.
Let me try a bit more again with Lars. In your remarks, you suggested that coefficient of relative risk aversion of 10 was kind of too high, and 100 certainly too high, which I take it comes from either introspection or micro studies, which I found difficult to organize. I don't know what you think is reasonable, but now you seem to be saying that model uncertainty is sort of equivalent to raising the effective rate of time preference, so this may be less of a concern. So that's not what I found in this particular example that I looked at, which is if you're uncertain about the policy effectiveness, it seems that you tend to get that you do kind of less investment, so it's as if the risk aversion was actually lower. It depends on the way in which uncertainty enters into the model in terms of what the results are. So I don't think it's true that all kinds of uncertainty are going to magnify the case for intervention to reduce tail risk. You don't always get that kind of result.
Okay, so I'm happy to take up this one as well. So the one result I was referring to is the fact that there's a ways to imitate Epstein's Zinn risk aversion by having agents concerned about model misspecification, and that works in some very special circumstances. More generally, the notion about not knowing parameters, when does that lead to more conservative behavior or when does it not, when does it lead you to be more reactive or less reactive, that I agree is a case-by-case basis. And yeah, certainly in other calculations, I don't know how to sort that out short, sort of feeding the D2 that tells the model and doing calculations. The insight which you gave to Brainerd, which many of us also give to Friedman from decades earlier, about more caution is a very, very special result, and that can sometimes happen. I do think there may be a more interesting thing about when we don't know stuff very well, does that lead us to want to do things, policies that are more simple until we understand the subtleties better? I think that's a really important question. Does uncertainty lead us to want to do more simple, more simple rules now and until we understand better what the complexities are? But that doesn't mean we don't do things, it just means maybe we do simpler things. But even that's not a theorem that I can establish yet. But I agree with you that the issue about I think uncertainty can make you more cautious, but how that more cautious shows up in terms of actions is not at all clear. So that has to be resolved on a kind of model-specific basis.
Okay, so following up on that, the policy recommendation that economists seem to have converged on is that we should price carbon emissions. Bob raised the point that the aviation industry right now, at least parts of the aviation industry, are making a big effort to put a price on carbon for their usage. So let me raise kind of the general question of, is pricing carbon the right solution? And what are the obstacles then to getting this politically implemented, to the extent that we as economists can talk about this knowledgeably? So certainly there's a big coordination problem in the sense that we'd have to get a lot of countries with different interests and with lots of heterogeneity to agree on this. So Raj, do you want to start off by commenting on this?
Yes, I mean, at one level, it is a fairly straightforward problem. I mean, you could have, if you knew the marginal private cost and you knew the marginal social cost, a Pigouvian tax would take care of this thing. But the point is that at the macro level, this is fine at the micro level, but you really have no idea what these, I might have some idea of my marginal private cost, but what is the marginal social cost? So that's a a huge problem, and there's a group at Dartmouth which Richard Haworth and his colleagues it's the Environmental School and the Thayer School, and they have come up with these estimates ranging from these are serious guys, $27,500 to $40, to $4. Because it depends when you intervene. I mean, the price of carbon will depend whether you intervene today or you intervene 5 years from now. So there is no such thing as the price of carbon unless you define what the time path is. And I personally think that if you want to do this as an insurance policy, if somebody was to give me a number, which says, well, if the temperature rises by 6 degrees, we're in a lot of trouble. We will have to keep it below 6 degrees. then that's a simple problem. You really then basically don't have to worry about many of these issues here, because what you can do is then you basically do a hard, you know, a cap on emissions. You auction off permits for a year and say, well, we're going to allow you only to pollute this much, and this could be dynamically updated every 10 years or something like that. So basically, you would get a price, but it'll have a far better control than a carbon tax, because you really don't have to worry about elasticities of, you know, how these things will react to a tax, et cetera. So if push came to shove, I would go for cap and trade, provided I knew with some degree of certainty as to, you know, what target is going to be fatal for us.
You know, there was an interesting paper recently by Marty Weitzman on this that focused on the game theory issue associated with creating a global agreement. And what he points out is that when you're negotiating quantities and you have all these different countries sitting around the table, as kind of is going on in the UN process, all of those countries have an incentive to do as little as possible because they benefit from everyone else's actions while only their own action is costly. Whereas if you negotiate on prices and try to agree on what would be the optimal price, then everyone has incentive to get the right answer because we all benefit from everyone else's action and we all pay the same cost. So I thought that was an interesting insight. That's why one of the reasons why I think it's very strategic to start with aviation, because it's creating a global benchmark price rather than focusing on quantities per country.
But that still raises the question, when do you price as of what time, after how much of intervention? I mean, if you the price of carbon, if you do nothing for 10 years, is going to be quite different than if you start.
Of course, you're pricing a scarce resource, yeah. And of course, the right answer is you price immediately. You don't wait, right? And I think the insight of risk management is that you have to be cautious when you don't know what the right quantity is. You don't know how much safe emissions there are left to be produced. You want to act cautiously to avoid the worst case outcome, which is to say, you really want to act more aggressively given that uncertainty and hope that you find things aren't as bad as might be the case. And then if information is revealed that things aren't as bad, the price should come down over time. If on the other hand you learn things are worse, the price should go up. But the real question is how high should it be today given that uncertainty? That's what makes it a little bit complicated. That's why I started out with that slide about the when you see something coming at you with a lot of uncertainty, you act cautiously. You break aggressively today so that you expect this problem to be solved.
I agree with Raj's discussion that of course, in order to know what kind of Pigouvian tax would be optimal, you really need a lot of information about social marginal costs that you don't have. There's also a political economy issue, which is a sort of general caution about too much power being allocated to government officials, and efficient interventions tend to be more dangerous in this respect than ones that are heavily distorting. And this comes up, for example, if you think about a VAT versus an income tax, and of course, a VAT looks like it's always much better, but it also tends to be utilized more and to be sort of more dangerous in the hands of public officials. So I don't know. I worry about Pigouvian taxes in this regard precisely because they have a certain kind of efficiency character to them.
Let's dive into another topic, which Bob raised, which was there's been a big movement recently pushing for university endowments and other investment groups to disinvest in industries that are responsible for large quantities of carbon emissions. So how should we think about this movement from an economic perspective? I think, Bob, you probably view that as a very good thing. I know, for one, Ivo Welch had an editorial in the New York Times where he argued very vociferously against this. Any other perspectives from the panelists here? Lars, you look like you're about to say something.
I don't know why we had to get deep in the story of divestiture. It seems to me like the university should do what's in their best interest. We should figure out how to tax. We should figure out as a policy measure how to address the externalities when they're there. But working through divestiture policy seems counterproductive to me. But.
If I could just add to that, I don't disagree with Lars. I've argued that, first of all, it shouldn't focus on fossil fuels, which is what the divestment movement is talking about. We should focus on stranded assets. Stranded assets defined as assets that will be negatively impacted by the pricing of emissions, or I would say, to be a little bit more precise, negatively impacted by increased expectations of the pricing of emissions. Well, I think that can be a very positive, NPV to the portfolio. As you know, if you look at what we did at WWF, it's a stranded asset swap, which is to say, it's a bet that stranded assets will underperform the market. That's presumably going to reduce the risk in the portfolio and increase expected returns. The other thing I would like to point out.
Can I ask you about that? Yeah. I wasn't quite sure I was understanding the numbers you were putting up on that. So you were saying it was systematically the case that you could sort of outperform something by taking advantage of these?
No, it was underperforming.
Well, the way I would put it is that the valuation of stranded assets today reflects a certain expectation of pricing of emissions. If that's correct, then those assets are appropriately priced. But to the extent that valuation is based on expecting emissions won't be priced for a long time, then those assets are misvalued. In fact, you might argue that the true value of those assets is very low today because of their externality. They're producing a negative externality. So if you actually priced in that externality, you wouldn't be valuing those assets where they're currently trading. And so it's
but
really.
But you're predicting that they will get priced in?
Yes.
In a way that the market is
yes.
not predicting.
Yes, exactly. Predicting that they will get priced in sooner and at higher levels than the market expects.
So the market's wrong right now.
Yeah, well, it seems to be recognizing that.
So I mean,
the easier case would be from the point of view of risk management. That would be straightforward. But you seem to go beyond that.
Well, it reduces risk, and if you believe that the market is wrong about the expectations of pricing, then it increases expected returns. And to the extent that you're an endowment or an educational institution, and you feel that part of your mission is to appropriately price emissions, then it aligns the portfolio with your mission.
Right, but if you got to a state where it was the opposite, where
if it got
pricing,
to the point,
then you'd recommend that the universities do the opposite.
Exactly.
Apparently.
Exactly.
So.
So it's a bet on expectations of emissions pricing.
Right.
And I think those expectations are going to increase over the next, short period of time.
So I was confused. Why limit this to in university environment? This is a general portfolio problem. There's actually a fairly interesting paper by Ravi Bansal and a guy called Marcelo Osha. And it's been hanging around for a while. And they drawn regressions on, temperature versus price dividend ratios or something. I haven't read it recently. But they find a negative relationship. And then what they do is they look at assets which are heavily energy intensive, like construction, and then at the other end, technology or something else. And then they form a long short portfolio and then do a cross-sectional regression and they can actually get a risk premium for temperature. So it is almost like a factor model and one could use that. But I don't see what is specific to, I thought your question was more on a moral suasion point of view that this is, Harvard is divesting of something and therefore, that would send a signal. But otherwise, from a portfolio allocation point of view, we would do exactly the maybe.
I
you
assume
buy
the
more.
Emphasis on universities was because of the hidden viewpoint that they were not just trying to maximize some financial thing, but were so susceptible to some kind of moral suasion, and then be willing to take positions that would be kind of adverse to your financial position, but I mean, that's not what Bob was just saying.
No, that's right. I mean, that's what I understood the question. So there was this guy, there's a guy,
all investors.
There is a guy called Satyarthi. I don't know how many of you heard of him. All my life, I never knew about this person. Suddenly in October, there was an announcement out of Oslo giving him the Nobel Prize. Now, the point is that he'd been doing excellent, exceptional work all his life in terms of, you know, rescuing children from bonded labor and child labor and things like that. But just by highlighting the problem, I think that's a public service. Similarly, if Harvard was, so that, you know, that signaling thing works for a while, but I don't particularly buy into that argument for divestment or anything. But from a portfolio management point, why not?
Let me raise one more question, and then we'll open it up to the audience. One of the kind of most celebrated reports in the economics of climate literature now is the Stern Report, which was, the principal author was Sir Nicholas Stern, and as Robert and a couple other people, I think, noted, he argues for a very, very low discount rate for future damages there. Now, part of his argument is that if we use standard market prices, those don't properly embed ethical considerations. And on that basis, argues that you should be discounting these future damages from climate change at a very, very low rate. So I guess I'd like, my sense is this doesn't make a lot of sense. But I'm curious to see if anybody else up here has a different reaction to that.
I never know what the market discount rate is. I thought we discount different cash stochastic cash flows in different ways, and so I don't even know what a market discount rate is.
Stern's not very.
I mean, we can talk about discounting in some specification of preferences if you want, but you know. I find the whole conversation confusing.
Okay.
You know, from a philosophical perspective, I didn't see the argument in a democracy for using something different from what the representative voter currently around wants to do. And that's going to include the fact that parents care about their children, et cetera, and there's going to be intergeneral linkages. But I don't know why you'd want to go beyond that as some kind of a dictator. The only argument I've heard that makes sense along those lines is that individuals kind of care about the welfare of their children and sort of factor that in. So if you think people care a lot about other people's children, then that's what could be internalized by some social planner. But I don't think it's a very important point. But more significantly, I mean, the Stern Review obviously trying at a political basis very hard to make a strong case for environmental investment. And I think they sort of missed the boat because they don't need this kind of silly argument about low discount rates to make the case that they want to make. And I think at a technical level, they kind of messed up. And if you take the disaster perspective with significant risk aversion, that's can give you bigger effects than what they wanted, actually, and be less subject to kind of attack on logical grounds about what is meaningful.
Excellent. Okay, why don't we open it up? We have about 10 minutes remaining. So any questions from the audience? Yes. Okay, if you could speak a little louder, please. We'll repeat the question.
Okay. Thank you very much. My name is Johnson Kaku from Morehouse College in Atlanta, Georgia. My question is for Professor Hansen. You have presented three kinds of uncertainty. And I think global climate change is a externality problem with many countries involved as player, and there is a lot of strategic interaction. And there might be also a lot of maybe uncertainty about those strategic interaction. In which class will you put this kind of uncertainty? The uncertainty about the action of other players like China, Russia, and they have different cost damage, And how will this affect the asset pricing for temperature and more and overall the global wealth in the world?
So I guess this is concerns about the uncertainty about how different countries will interact around the world in trying to address climate change. Do I have the question correct?
I agree that's an important point about certainty that I have little, I wish I had a simple answer to it. I would find it, you know, I personally find it very, very hard to quantify and think about. You know, it's certainly a huge problem about how we would want to structure meaningful global responses to climate change. So I don't have any magical simple answer for it. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I would just add to that that when you think about the global negotiations on climate, one of the problems is that global negotiations inside the UN have for many decades been really focused on income inequality and how do you address that issue, which is a very complicated issue and one that is unlikely to be resolved for a long time, whereas climate change is a risk management issue that needs to be addressed immediately. And so I think what we need to do is really separate the issues of income inequality from relative pricing of emissions, and hopefully by doing that we can make some progress.
Question?
I was interested in the personal portfolio question that came up earlier with the hedging and so forth, and Beryl raised the point that maybe even in an efficient market you want to hedge your risk. But I wonder if that's right, because wouldn't pretty much everybody want to hedge? That is, sell short the carbon intensive stocks, because if there's a big disaster, we'll all be worse off and we'll want to make money off our short that we've lost from the global disaster. So that should be priced in already, so it would only be those who are most exposed already, which, interestingly enough, probably wouldn't be the universities. It seems like they're pretty immune, more immune than most people to the carbon prices going up. Shouldn't it be the Texas oil millionaires who should be doing this? So we should see them now hedging by shorting carbon-intensive stocks?
We do see that, actually. A lot of people are hedging against, you know, I wouldn't be long carbon in the next 20 years. And a lot of people who are trading energy are actually hedged against these risks. And actually, the carbon tax at the rate of about $20 a ton is pretty much priced. If you talk to energy traders and hedge funds which are trading this thing, so they have already priced it in the range of $20, $25. Bob would know more about it, but I just casual conversation, I've seen that people are hedging against that.
Yeah, I think there's quite a heterogeneity of expectations, and it's sometimes difficult because you have these surveys. For instance, Exxon recently, talked about an expected carbon price of I think it was $80 a ton or something, but. Of course, it was also in 2050, so you know you have to have a date associated with it, and often people talk as if it's not a function of time. It clearly is a function of time, so it's really a question of what you expect about the whole forward curve. And but your point about the risk is a good one, although I would tell you that unless you're a Texas oil billionaire or whatever with a huge allocation to carbon, a typical portfolio, for instance, at the WWF, we quantified our exposure to stranded assets, and it was about less than 1% of the portfolio. So in fact, I wouldn't overemphasize the risk to the portfolio itself from increased expectations of emissions pricing. But it's really a response to the reaction that you shouldn't do anything that would hurt the portfolio, to say, well, look, you are reducing risk. You may be increasing expected returns if you think emissions are going to get priced sooner than current expectations, which are hard to know what they really are. And so it's more of a reaction to excuses why we're not going to do anything than this is a major risk in the portfolio.
I would have guessed that there's a global macro disaster of a Great Depression type, that the tendency to tax carbon would be considerably diminished. So I would think these assets would actually do pretty well in the event of a macro disaster. And maybe the fact that they're not doing well when there is no disaster is sort of compensation for that. It seems like they should be pretty good disaster hedges.
All right. In the back.
Yes. Nobody's mentioned politics or the war revolution. I think this work Africa and other parts of the world linking climate shocks with events like revolution and war.
Any comments on that? Revolution and war.
Sounds like yours.
I suspect there's very little expertise up here about that, but certainly it is true that one of the, I would say, leading reasons why governments now are very concerned about this is because the military is starting to say, yeah, look, this is a cause of a lot of unrest, and it's going to get worse, and that's going to be one of the bigger costs associated with climate over the next several decades.
You know, on the other side, historically, war is the major source of macro disaster events. And as in the comment I made previously, I would think in the event of war, there'd be much less inclination to tax your coal and oil resources. So it would be a similar kind of effect where you might think that those assets would do well in that kind of disturbance.
Yeah, but Robert, I don't think you can think of pricing of emissions as sort of a long-term risk that's going to be sort of in equilibrium. That the pricing of emissions is going to happen. It's just a question of when. And so you don't want to think of that as being a risk factor that's sort of out there hedging wars.
Well, I mean, if you take the data you presented seriously, then it is a hedge. I mean, it's giving you a minus 18% relative to the S&P and minus 30-something else, which are the type of assets which give negative rates of returns. These are going to be hedges, and insurance is against some state of very high marginal utility. Well, basically, I entirely agree with you, Robert. If you take that data seriously and and say this is a correct price, or you could say it's mispriced, that's a separate.
Okay, we have time for one more question. If there's any final questions,
yeah, there's one right in front.
Professor Barrow, it seems like the majority of your events that you described as catastrophes are relatively uninsurable events. Do you try to back out the effect of insurance at all to kind of capture the main impact of large events?
There is a large data set, including events that are insured or not insured, which are much smaller kinds of natural disaster type events, which I know some people have been working with. It's not the kind of thing that I'm thinking of from a macro perspective, which is more involved with this sort of aggregate risk. And then the definition of a macro disaster here was just in terms of what happened to GDP, and then it had to fall by 10% or more. And it just turns out that none of the kind of events that I think you're referring to were big enough to show up at the country level in that data set, which I found surprising. I didn't anticipate that. But
it sounds like many of the events that you did describe as catastrophes that were large mortality events as opposed to destroying property.
Well, wars are like that, yes. But they tend to, I think wars typically destroy more physical than human capital, but they do destroy both. And of course, depression-type events, which are the other really big source of macro disasters, are not particularly mortality events, despite some stockbrokers jumping out of windows. I think that's not all that big a deal.
Okay. Well, I'd like to thank all of the panelists and thank the audience for your questions and for showing up at the session. Thanks. Thank you.